It's been a month since 86% of our currency was deemed illegal. And as part of a special series, Agenda is going to campuses across the country, especially in places where elections are expected, to talk to young people and, of course, our special panelists over there to talk about the impact that demonetization has had. Today, we're at the famous Sophia College, and it's wonderful to have an all-women audience here and a special guest to talk about the demonetization impact, especially if it is in any way impacting the elections. Remember, just a few days ago, when we saw Maharashtra civic poll results coming out, the BJP government was very quick to point out that was a vote for demonetization. That's what was said in Gujarat as well. But the opposite, in fact, was claimed by West Bengal Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee, who said her win was a vote against demonetization. So what is it really? We'll ask our guests. Joining us, of course, one of India's best known authors, Kiran Nagarkar, is a very political writer of novels like Ravan and Eddie. Thanks very much for being here. From the Congress, yes, from the Congress we have Sanjay Jha. From the BJP we have Shaina NC, and the head of the Department of Economics here of Sophia College, Dr. Sangeeta Dubey. So first off, I'll start off not with the politicians, but Kiran Nagarkar. As a writer, as someone who interacts and looks at people, and as an observer of life, really, it's been a month now since this note ban has come in. And your books deal a lot with the politics that you see here in Maharashtra. If you look at the state as such, or the larger picture, what impact do you see?
I think I see extremely serious impacts in many areas. But obviously the worst affected are the poor, the farmers. I think the lower middle class is also very badly affected, and you won't believe this, but I have never used a card in my life, okay? So I was returning from Gurgaon last night, and I found that I didn't have enough for the cab. So I was hanging out there, begging someone or the other to give me change, because I had a 2,000 rupee note and nothing else. So if you'll forgive my saying so, even I was petrified that I could not manage to go home easily.
But did you manage to get the change?
No. They had to send someone over to the airport to bring me back some change, really. But I think the inconvenience, to put it in the lightest terms possible, that the poor are suffering, and the farmers, the small vendors. This is completely, even if, you know, I'm not an economist, so I will not get into the rights or wrongs of demonetization, but I do feel that they suffered and are suffering even to this day, because when I went to the, whatever that gadget is where you get your money out, I don't even know the name.
ATM.
I get confused with Paytm, but that as expected had closed down. I mean, you know, and I believe the people working there said, "Oh, it has been like this for a long time." So then, how do we expect the farmers, the small vendors, to survive when they stand in the queues for 8 hours or maybe more? Some of them pass out. Some of them pass out permanently. So I find that very, very difficult to grasp, because this could have been easily avoided. There was no forethought. Even the business about the notes, the size being changed, was completely unnecessary. If you're going to change the legal tender from 500 and 1,000 to 500 and 2,000, all you had to do was to keep just the same size at least, but that was not done. But there is something else which bothers me perhaps just as much, if not more. We have with us Shaina Ji, and I'm extremely glad that she is there, because she's one of those very few people who does not become vicious or offensive or truly aggressive when a different point of view is stated?
Ask me.
Shainaji also? Oh my God. But when I hear the people in Delhi, and I'm talking about the top leaders, I don't want to get into their names and things, I'm aghast at they seem to think that anything which is a different opinion, even a slight variation or a difference in approaches, and they're down on you like a ton of bricks. But I cannot believe that in a democracy you cannot accept that there are, it's wonderful that there are differences of opinion. I mean, this is what a democracy is about. And if someone can just tell me how nationalism has crept into this issue. If you're not with them, at least President Bush said that either you're with us or you're against us. But this is 1 or 10 steps ahead. If you're not with us, you're anti-national. Where's that coming from? I'm completely foxed by this. It has never even occurred to me that I would be considered anti-national. I was born here. I write about nothing else but this country.
Anyone called you an anti-national recently?
Oh, time and again. I even get death threats. So what's the problem? Anyway, I've held on for too long. Thank you very much.
Shanansi, do you want to respond to that? Because it's something that a lot of people are saying. In fact, the recent send-up or parody that's been done by a lot of young comics has been about the fact that everyone, if you try to say anything, they'll tell you that don't you care about the soldiers. Whereas people like Kiran Agarkar are saying, this is an economic issue. Why is my criticism or my point of view, if it's different, why is it equated with that?
Firstly, Kiranji, nobody is going to come down heavily on you, and nobody is going to call you anti-national. You're entitled to your opinion. And I hope you will be welcoming of my opinion on this issue.
Absolutely.
Now, 70 years post-independence, this is the first time you have a historic decision taken by a man who has the courage of conviction to say enough is enough. In 1978, we talked about 80 crores. Today, in 2016, the figure is an astounding 14 lakh crores. For all you girls who are studying economics, you would understand better than me that what a decision like this impacts is bound to have a momentary inconvenience. Now, this inconvenience that we talk about, it could be the higher strata, the middle income, or the lower income. Mm-hmm. But look at the kind of public support. Look at the people who are saying, we're willing to bear this, we're willing to go with this 50 days that you've asked for, because this is going to be the last of our lines. What is this money going to be used for? Surely not Narendra Modi or his coffers, because he's a man of integrity and this entire country knows it. This is being used purely for infrastructure, for the betterment of our country, for rural growth, for people who have Jandhan accounts but have nothing to replenish it with. And here you have a system which has come into place. I do concede there has been inconvenience, there are lacunas in the system. But if you are talking about a public mandate, and if we are talking about the poor, Kiranji, please look at the election results. In Maharashtra today, you have 51 mayorships of these councils that have gone to BJP, where we weren't even 8. Yeah. You have the second party at 25. It shows you public sentiment. You see the results in Gujarat, where you're talking about the Patidar Andolan. Despite that, BJP wins 107 of 123. You're talking about Mamata Banerjee. This is the first time the BJP has got 28% of the vote share. I'm not saying this is about electoral gain, but since you have questioned us, is this what public is talking about? You ask any of these girls here to put their hands up and to tell you if they stand with this decision or not.
Well, let's have a show of hands then.
How many of you all stand by this decision?
That's a minority.
Well, you need to know why the others don't. But I would only want to say I'm an eternal optimist. And I know that this is the only prime minister that has made a decision.
Shiv Sena, your allies, have said it would be foolish. The people who think that are fools.
Maybe they are fools because they've lost.
these two and a half years that the Prime Minister has been at the helm of affairs in India, one of the things that has bothered me is that within the party itself, I never hear even a murmur of dissent, you know. But surprisingly, the Times of India today carries a Hindu Mahasabha article where they distinctly say that, as a matter of fact, is demonetization going to turn out to be demoditikai? What is it? How do you pronounce it? I don't even know. Now, the point is,
it's
whatever. But the point is, it's good to hear someone within the party occasionally saying something which might be at variance.
Why is that good, sir?
Because it shows that the party is alive.
Yeah.
I mean, that it's not just a crowd of yes men and women.
I just wanted to come to you, Sanjay Jha, about, do you agree when they say that they have got some electoral benefit out of it, that very soon after, these first round of civic polls in spread across quite a few states are actually a vote for demonetization?
You know, Sunetra, in all honesty, I don't know. I mean, this is wonderful to have so many young women here. And I'm a big pro-feminist, so I'm delighted to have this audience. I can tell you this for a fact, that today I read a report. I don't know how many of you have read about that. A woman set herself ablaze in frustration because she could not get the exchange for the denomination she was looking for. To me, Sunetra, that's a manifestation of the fact that the demonetization has been a disaster with a capital D. Any policy that any government brings in is supposed to make your life easier. It's supposed to make your life more convenient. Now, all of you are from Mumbai. Right? We're all young, urban, you know, we all have access to smartphones. But just for a moment, think and just get into the details. You and I may have credit card and Paytms, but 98% of India's transactions are in cash in terms of volumes, 98%. Now, so far, since Mr. Modi's dramatic with full flourish announcement on November 8th, the last count, the number of people who have died standing in queues or related to that is now reaching roughly 90. 90 people dead. Trust me, Sunetra, in any other country in the world, there would be an outrage. How is the death of 90 people merely a statistic?
But how is it related to elections?
No, I'm bringing it down to the elections. And I want to puncture my good friend Shaina's extremely over-exaggerated belief that the audience is actually accepting that hypothesis. Let me give an example. Mr. Modi, and this is why I think the young need to be clued in, claimed through a tweet that the Maharashtra civic results were an endorsement of demonetization.
Yeah.
When I read that, I took a deep breath and then I couldn't stop laughing for a long time. It wasn't chlorine, promise you that. You know what I discovered? That Mr. Modi, very conveniently, he's the Prime Minister of India. Why should the Prime Minister link the supposed biggest step of his prime ministership to a Maharashtra civic result? It got me thinking. Strange. Because BJP has lost many elections in the past and he has never expressed his dismay at their poor performance. Then I looked at the numbers. The numbers are interesting, ladies and gentlemen. Because in the 2000 results that have just come out of the civic results, the BJP got, and look at the figures, 897 seats. The number of seats that were being contested, 897 out of 3,700 seats.
Maybe you'd want to...
Yeah, hang on. The Congress got, hear it, the Congress got 727. The NCP got 615. The Shiv Sena got 519. I have the exact numbers. Independents got 522. And others got around 400 odd. Look at the distribution. Now, let me make it very easy for you. The BJP wins 24% of the seats. The Congress wins 20%. The NCP wins 18%.
But percentage-wise, the difference in 2014 was also much less.
No, the truth is that the Congress and the BJP difference is 4% based on 2011 results. But if you compare it 2014 when BJP won.
But at the end of it, Sanjay, it's how many seats won.
Truth, ladies and gentlemen, and this is critical for you to understand, that demonetization is actually what Dr. Manmohan Singh, and a renowned economist, said is a disaster and an operational failure of a mammoth proportion. The common man is suffering. The real black marketers, by the way, have parked their monies abroad. And Mr. Modi, of course, loves his capitalist
Dr. Dubey, the Congress and the BJP will have their own take on things. As an economist, how do you see it? Do you think it is a vote for demonetization in Maharashtra?
Comment first on something which I've been hearing on almost all media news and something which has been said by most of the BJP leaders, that people are patient. People are patient and they are waiting patiently.
Yeah.
So how much they are cooperating and they are tolerant. I would just like to ask one thing. Do we have a choice? Do I have a choice instead of waiting? I mean, my money is parked in the bank. If I need my money, do I have a choice? Should I go on writing? So I don't see the impact seen now, but maybe in the future. But what could be the impact would be very, very disastrous as far as the economy is concerned. And that could be reflected somewhere in the political scenario too. So when I hear something like this, that people have been patient,
but the fact that they're not protesting as much, Dr. Dubey, is that an implicit support for the larger cause? Because many people are saying if they were, then we would see...
They're dying. That's the worst form of protest.
It breaks the banking rules per se. The bank says that the depositor is the first liability of the bank. Today, if I have to get my money, I have to wait in the queue very patiently. If I go on rioting, am I going to get my money? What if tomorrow something happens to the bank, my money is lost? Or tomorrow some more rigorous decision is made. Let me also point out to the fact that nobody has spoken about it. I don't know why. Like saying, telling people that you cannot consume more than this, or you cannot take so much of money, even if you have lakhs of money in your account, you are not supposed. Who is somebody to decide how much do I want to spend?